Well, just as I thought. A mangy shoe salesman and a chronically unemployed aging pretty boy. Have them thrown off the property immediately.
Jeez, I can't believe she said that.
Me either. Aging? Now, Redford, that's aging.
Let's rock.
Thanks, Dad.
Can I get it open?
Whoa, buddy!
No Man presents, live from the nudie bar, the Married with Children podcast.
Welcome back to the Married with Children podcast. This is Luigi. And my stomach is so empty right now that the only thing in it is a commemorative Slim Jim left over from Super Bowl XII.
And I'm Alga, and I just died and went to the land of milk and honeys.
Hi, and I'm Sheila, and I think it's unprofessional for agents to date their clients. All right, there, Million Man March.
We are reviewing Season 10, Episode 9, The Two That Got Away. Original air date, November 19, 1995. Al and Jefferson go away for the weekend to a fishing lake in upstate Wisconsin. But when they arrive at the fishing lodge, they are rudely told to leave when Shannon Tweed, a famous B-movie actress and former Playboy Playmate, has taken their reservation. But when the guys arrive home, they discover that Jefferson had inadvertently snapped a photo of Shannon seducing the lodge owner in a hot tub as the reason why they were kicked off the property. As payback, Al and Jefferson decide to throw a tabloids auction to see which magazine will get the photo. Meanwhile, Bud casts Lucky the dog in a dog food commercial, but Lucky will only act unless Kelly performs the scene first. Director, Amanda Bierce. Writers, Al Edekman. Special guest stars, Shannon Tweed as herself, Joey Segal as Randolph, Leland Orser as the director, Alden Milliken as the trash. I forgot who that is. Shay Marks as Inga, Donna DeErico as Helga, Jasmine Paul as Star Disher, Joey Dente as Daily Scandal, Mary Harper Jones as Stage Mom, Lucky the Dog as Lucky the Dog, Kevin Schoen as the TV announcer, and Kim Weisskopf as the voice of Lucky.
Al's got a nude photo of Shannon Tweed, and she'll do anything to get it back.
If you weren't married.
Oh, I'm not married.
On Married with Children, coming up next.
So welcome back, everyone.
And today, we have a special guest co-host,
Sheila. Sheila, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so 2 weeks ago on the podcast, the fans got to hear sort of someone who I had done a little stroll down memory lane with on Married with Children World, which was Mr. B from my high school. So this week, we have another friend of mine from high school, Sheila, who... I would say you're not a rabid Married with Children fan, but, you know, you did like it back in the day.
Yeah, I have an appreciation for it. And, you know, any time I get a chance to, like, get on a podcast and talk with some old friends and some new friends, I'm always here for it.
Yeah. So, Sheila, why don't you tell us, why don't you tell the fans a little bit about yourself and your TV viewing habits and a little bit about your podcast?
Thanks so much for asking. I do a lot of podcasting with another friend of ours from high school who has a podcast network with two friends of his, and their network is called Pot Clubhouse. So they formed in about January of 2020. I joined them in about March of 2020 as my pandemic pastime, something to do to fill the time. And I'm up to like 100 and something podcasts later. So they keep having me back. I've covered such shows as Yellowstone, The Alienist. What else have I covered? Younger, Girls Five Eva.
That's a great show, by the way.
Oh my God, it's so funny. If you have not watched it, it's on Peacock. It's an unabashed plug right now, but it's for people of a certain age who get nostalgic for time immemorial with terms of music. And it's a slice and dice of 90s music. So it's very biting. It's very funny. It's very sarcastic. It's definitely completely right up my alley.
Yeah. Well, Sheila, what do you think this podcast is?
Well, exactly. So this is why this is a really good fit. So, you know, the more you can take the fun out of something and, you know, point it in a different direction, I'm here for it.
So Sheila, what did you think of Married with Children, like, the first time? Do you have any, like, remembrances of the first time you saw it, or maybe, like, some of the talk about it, like, from your perspective, especially from the female perspective? We're always interested in hearing about that.
Well, you know, I guess as time has gone on, I guess my feelings about certain jokes and things, like, have changed. But, like, I was watching this episode. I haven't seen Married with Children now in a number of years. And I was like, oh, it's on Hulu. So that's good, because I have, like, all the streaming services. But I remember watching this first run. I was about, what, 9 years old when it came out in 1987. So I watched it. Was it on, like, Luigi, was it on, like, Sunday nights or something?
That's right.
Yeah, so I remember
watching it. It was the famous Sunday night lineup. And you know what?
Yeah.
Even Chris was a 5-year-old watching the show.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, I don't know why I was allowed to watch it at that age, but I did.
I'm going to really say that a lot of the stuff went over your head.
Oh, yeah, way over. I mean, it's so funny. I get, you know, watching it as an adult, I get all the adult jokes. So it's a different type of funny. And as a kid, I enjoyed it because it was wild. It was crazy. It was zany, you know. I enjoy it differently now as an adult.
Yeah, like, I was watching it now, and I was just like, I don't know how this would go over in a 2021, you know, audience with its different sensibilities and things like that. But, I mean, I was laughing because, like, I just find it funny. I miss the atmosphere that a live studio audience brings to a show. Like, I forgot that it was recorded in front of a live audience. So, like, you know, when Kelly walks in, everyone's screaming for her. And when Peg and Al are talking about, you know, the back and forth jibes between them, and then, you know, the crowd going, oh, to all, like, the disses. I miss that. I miss that level of interaction, I think, with TV shows. So I enjoyed that piece of it too. And just the biting humor, the wit, I really enjoyed coming back to this.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that they've talked about, you know, Chris and I have discussed this briefly, but this was what you call a traditional 3-camera sitcom. And most sitcoms nowadays are no longer made this way. A lot of things are single camera. And again, and single camera, and also in sets that are, you know, built a certain way. Like, you really don't have studio audience the way that this was done. I mean, and, you know, you're talking about shows going back to The Honeymooners and I Love Lucy that were done that way. And, you know, I'd say that in the last 20 years, that genre has disappeared. So it's very nostalgic in terms of, like, I think for someone who are our ages, you know, we grew up watching shows like that, so it's very comfortable to us. And, you know, I'm really curious about someone who is, you know, let's say 20 watching the show, and, you know, how they view it. I mean, do they view it as, like, a very antique way of doing it? I mean, just forget about the jokes, but just from, like, a production standpoint, you know, I'd always be curious to know, like, what their opinion is vis-a-vis what people are doing today.
They probably do view it that way, sort of like someone my age, for example, when I was a kid, watching, like, the Andy Griffith Show being in black and white, or, you know, one of the really, really older shows that was shot in black and white, you know?
Yeah, I don't know what, you know, someone who would roll up to the show first run now would think of it. I just don't know if they would just, like, this can't be for real. You know, I think that would be sort of their feeling about it.
Yeah. And we're in season 10 now. So this is the 9th episode of season 10. And this is sort of, you know, we're getting toward the end of the show's run. You know, so to the maniacs, the married maniacs, like myself and Chris and our other co-hosts, you know, what we always talk about is, you know, the early seasons, there was a lot more realism in terms of the situations and even the dialogue. Now, you know, this is really, at this point in time in season 10, Married with Children was much more of a pop culture icon. And pretty much everybody and their mother wanted to be on the show. You know, a lot of the dialogue is no longer about the family and the family dynamics. And now it's more about what's going on in the greater world. So some of the comments that we've gotten on Facebook has been that the podcast itself, if you look at our early seasons when our creator Alex was doing this, they were a lot shorter. I mean, have you noticed that, Chris? It's like, you know, an Alex podcast would maybe go an hour to an hour and a half. You know, we are averaging more like 2 hours. And the only reason is because there's a lot more pop culture references that we discuss. Because in the later seasons, beginning in season 8 in particular, through the end, there are a lot more pop culture references. Like, and this one has a slew of it. I mean, we have like 5 pages of notes to discuss today.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've got cracks at Roseanne. We've got the Million Man March. We've got a lot of different things that come up here.
Yeah. And, you know, we're always glad to have a female perspective. Now, actually, so Sheila, from your perspective, I mean, how would you view the show? I mean, a lot of women, you know, back in the 90s, you know, I said to them, like, I was a fan of Married with Children. They usually were like, oh, God, it's like, they would almost classify it as misogynistic.
It's not wrong. That's not a wrong sentiment. It pretty much is. But, I mean, it's also, it's meant to be, like, very tongue-in-cheek funny, but it did reinforce a lot of stereotypes, like with Peg, for instance, that she's lazy, she's conniving to always get his money and things like that. It just doesn't portray women, and Kelly's just dumb, right? So it doesn't portray women in a very favorable light. But I mean, are you watching Married to Children for the intellectual capacity, or are you watching it for the fun of it? Like, you have to be an intelligent consumer to know what you're consuming.
Right. But I also say, like, but the flip side is too, I mean, does it really paint, you know, Bud and Alan in a favorable light either?
No, it really doesn't. It's so, I mean, it's a double-edged sword, but oftentimes women are the one who get the butt of the jokes in the show. But I mean, like, the premise of Al, like, Al's just the guy who can never win. He can never catch a break.
Exactly. A lot of times whenever people say, well, they're like, well, Married with Children is sexist, or Married with Children is misogynist, or whatnot, I always, my response is usually, well, to a degree, it certainly is, but if you really truly watch the show over the years, the one who gets subjected the most and the one who loses the most is the star of the show himself, Al. You know, I mean, like, we can count on one hand the number of times Al actually wins over the years, you know?
It's the only time he got the touchdowns at Polk High. That's it, you know?
Yeah. There's no doubt about it. The person that subjects it the most on the show is Al himself, if you really think about it. I mean, this episode's a perfect example. I mean, he, and we'll get to that when we get to it, but he has a chance to win, but he, as always, shoots himself in the foot.
Now, actually, you know, Sheila, not to digress, I wanted to bring something up to our audience. So if you've listened to our podcast, you know, we have three different teams. So one of our teams is based in Australia, right? And Chris, you know, Sheila actually, I consider her bilingual in American and Australian. So do you want to maybe tell us a little bit about Australia, living in Australia as an American, and a little bit about your name, Sheila?
Oh, God. Yeah. So when I was in college, I had the great idea to go on a student exchange to Australia because it was one of the countries that spoke English as one of the offerings. And because I knew I'd be going by myself because most of my friends were like in like the pharmacy program or law. So they were like on a track and they couldn't deviate from it. I was a liberal arts major. I had room to wiggle. So I went there for my sophomore year. So halfway through my sophomore year, just because of their school year being different, I went in February and I ended up staying for about 2 years. I finished my college degree there. So the funny part about, you know, being in Australia with my name is people didn't think that that was actually my name because that's the pronoun, the slang that they use for girl. Like, so they would say, like, you know, there's a bunch of Sheilas over there. So oftentimes people would be like, oh, you're the one. Like, I was the one named Sheila. Or, like, I'd be talking to a guy in a bar, and, you know, after a little while, I'd be like, what's your name? I'm like, Sheila. He's like, well, you could have told me to screw off 2 hours ago if you didn't want to tell me your name. I'm like, no, really, this is what my parents named me. So, yeah, so they thought it was hilarious that my parents named me Sheila, and I went to go live there.
What part of Australia were you in?
I was in a town called Wollongong, which was about an hour south of Sydney.
Okay.
I was at a university there.
Yeah, I went to, I've been to Sydney before. I went there, spent a couple of weeks there back in 2018. And oddly enough, just a coincidence, I was a contestant on The Price is Right last year and won a trip to a vacation to Sydney.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
Yeah, I still haven't gone because the borders have been closed due to COVID, but I have that vacation waiting on me at some point, I'll use. So I love Australia.
Yeah, me too. I've just been like all over, went everywhere that I could go one of the 2 years that I was there. So beautiful country, lots of friends still there. So it's a fantastic place to visit. Just don't be named Sheila.
So, you know, another question I have for you, Sheila, like how did they deal with the Queen's accent?
Oh, I used to tell them I speak the Queen's English. They didn't believe me. I was like, no, I speak the 59th Street version of the Queen's English. When I was there, it was the late 90s. So there was like the show The Nanny was really popular. So they understood a lot of like the accent, and it was more like I'd be put on display. Like, here, say this word. Say water. Say table. Say, what else did I have to say? I said Manhattan. There was words I had to say. Oh, coffee. That, you know, they just wanted to hear me say because it's very stark. Yes, I was raised by immigrants, but I have a very strong Queens accent. And, you know, my husband says all the time that I can take the girl out of Queens, but can't take Queens out of the girl because it's there. And it's, you can't mistake where I come from when I open my mouth, for sure. But the nanny was pretty popular back then. So, like, you know, when I said, you know, she comes from Flushing, Queens. Well, I'm from Bayside, the next town over. I'm like, oh, okay.
And during that time, I was living in Flushing. So I think people equated living in Flushing to having that nanny accent. But
yeah, you know, they're like, oh, you don't sound like her. I'm like, yeah, I can. Get me angry.
No, but you know, the reality of it was that, you know, Fran Drescher really grew up in the 50s and 60s when Flushing was heavily Jewish. And people did speak that way. But, you know, by the time we were kids, you know, the sort of the demographic had changed. I mean, it became very Asian, particularly in the 90s. So, you know, you don't hear, like, that accent wasn't heard on the streets anymore. Like, I feel like that accent moved to Boca Raton, you know.
Yeah. Parts of Miami Beach and things like that.
That's right. Yeah, so that little segment's for our Annabelle, you know, because Annabelle, when she saw that we were having someone named Sheila on, she thought that was pretty funny. So I thought we should have a little for our American-based fans. It's like, what's so funny about having someone named Sheila on the show, right?
It'd be like having someone named Girl.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, it's very interesting when you go to the bathroom at a place and you're like, oh, it's my room. Everybody out. My name's on the door. Get out.
All right, so let's get underway. The title for this episode comes from a film entitled The One That Got Away, a 1957 World War II film starring Hardy Krueger and featuring Michael Goodliffe, Jack Glimmon, and Alec McCowan. I'm sorry, Sheila, I think it's a Gaelic name. The film was directed by Roy Ward Baker with a screenplay written by Howard Clues, based on the 1956 book of the same name by Kendall Burt and James Leeser. The film chronicles the true exploits of Oberlieutenant Franz von Vera, a Luftwaffe pilot shot over Britain in 1940. He initially tried to escape while captive in England, but was later successful during transfer to a Canadian POW camp. And we open the episode with Bud on the telephone.
Now look, JB, you see, I'm a reasonable man. Now see, if you don't give my client this audition, I'm gonna have to have 100 roses delivered to your wife in your girlfriend's name. Thanks, babe. See, I knew you'd see my way.
Hey, what is it? Did you get me an audition?
You?
No. I've discovered a major new talent.
I'll give you a hint. He just peed on the Darcy's roses.
Dad?
No. Lucky.
Yeah, but isn't it unprofessional for agents to date their clients?
It's very funny. Million Man March.
So what are your thoughts on Bud's trying to extort this guy named JP on the telephone?
Well, it's kind of smart, honestly. It sort of reminds me of something Jefferson would do. Jefferson's the one that's like usually the either extortionist or, you know, the one that's doing some sort of dirty deal or something to make money or whatever. But it was brilliant. And Kelly, you know, Kelly thought he got a job for her, but he actually got a job for Lucky. So.
Yeah, it was pretty smart because, you know, how else are you going to make a buck in this world if you're not going to be enterprising? So he just turns out to be a little bit smarter than the other guy he's dealing with. So can't fault him for that.
Yeah, I really love the line. He says, you know, I've discovered a new major talent. And I'll give you a hint. He just peed in the Darcy's roses. And Kelly goes right, like, oh, is that Dad?
And she really believes it, too. Like, she really felt that Dad.
So Kelly makes a crack to that it's unprofessional for agents to date their clients. So she's insinuating that Bud is dating Lucky.
That's why I took that as my quote for the joke in the beginning.
That this day is our day, and we want to let them know that the black contingent of men, women, and children have a significant vote in this country.
The Million Man March was a large gathering of African-American men in Washington, D.C. on October 16, 1995. Called by Louis Farrakhan, it was held on and around the National Mall. The National African-American Leadership Summit, a leading group of civil rights activists and the Nation of Islam working with scores of civil rights organizations, including many local chapters of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, but not the National NAACP, formed the Million Man March Organization Committee. The founder of the National African American Leadership Summit, Dr. Benjamin Chavis Jr., served as the national director of the Million Man March.
The Million Man March was something that had happened earlier in the year, and I guess really the joke is that they're just saying that Kelly is dating a million men.
But now, yeah. Like, so if you said that the Million Man March happened in October of 95 and this aired in November of 95, like, that was a pretty quick turnaround to get the joke in there.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. Well, that's one of the things we've talked about. You know, I think that, you know, in season 10, the writers, now, mind you, this is airing in November of 95. So you imagine it was shot about a month before. So, yeah. And if I way I remember the Million Man March, there was a big sort of like build up to it. It's not like sort of an event that happened. Like, there was press around it in the weeks leading up to it. So, really, like I said, in season 10, Married with Children is very in tune with pop culture. So, you know, I'm sure that all they're doing is, as things are happening in the world, like, they're putting that into the script. And I wouldn't be surprised if maybe some of these lines were added post-production, or maybe they shot a scene, you know, and it might have been right after the fact.
Yeah, you know, we've seen that before. It's a good call there. We've seen that before. I think it was Alex that pointed that out on the episode where someone had asked Bud, like, what's the cologne that you're wearing or whatever? And he said it's called the Buster Douglas special, One Punch and You're Knocked Out or something like that. And that was obviously a reference to Buster Douglas upsetting Mike Tyson whenever they fought. But when that episode aired, that fight, that upset had been like less than a month earlier whenever he beat Mike. So you would have to figure that would have had to have been added last minute, you know? And that that upset was still obviously fresh on everyone's mind at the time.
Even Lucky has a zinger.
It's a dog food commercial. Now all Lucky has to do is learn a few simple tricks and pretend to like the stuff.
No problem. I lick your face and pretend to like you.
But now I'm sorry to interrupt, but who was the voice of Lucky?
So one of the producers by the name of Kim Weisskopf, he was the voice of Lucky.
Oh, okay.
I mean, originally it was Kevin Coran, who was one of the show's writers in the early seasons. And then I believe it was beginning in season 8, it was Kim Weisskopf, and he remained the voice of Buck and then of Lucky. And we had, you know, the funeral of Buck the dog at episode 3 this season.
Pour one out for our homie.
So now Al and Peg come down the stairs.
Gee, Al. I've never heard of a 3-day funeral.
Perchance you don't remember our honeymoon.
Yes, something certainly died back then. Unfortunately, it never got buried. I just want you to look me in the face and tell me that you are not going fishing.
Peg, I lie about a lot of things. Who I'm married to, who my kids are, what that smell was, but I would never, ever lie about Aunt Betty's funeral.
I thought you said it was Aunt Nell.
It's a double funeral peg. Which is why it's gonna take 3 days. Well, four if they're biting. I mean, crying!
Al and Peg go back and forth because Peg thinks that Al is lying about going to a funeral, and instead she thinks that he's going on a fishing trip. Peg, I lie about a lot of things. Who I'm married to, who my kids are, what that smell was. But I never lie about Aunt Betty's funeral. I thought you said it was Aunt Nell. It's a double funeral, Peg.
That's why he's got to go for 3 days.
Well, he said he's going to go for 3 days or four if you're biting.
I mean, crying. With the faux tear, a little crocodile tear.
Marcy and Jefferson enter.
Okay, Al. You ready to go fishing?
What Jefferson means, Peg, is that the family said in lieu of bringing flowers, we should all bring fish. Let's go, Jefferson.
No, Al. No, my days as a cad and a bounder are over. I feel very strongly that you should never lie to your wife, and for one very good reason. What was it again, Marcy?
A lie may give you temporary pleasure, but honesty will bring you happiness at the end of the day. And I was so happy that Jefferson told me the truth about his trip that I've given him something very special.
Nobody wants to hear about your filthy chicken love.
No, Al, Marcy gave me this new telephoto lens for my camera. Look, trust me, Al, I know honesty goes against everything we guys stand for, but women eat it up.
All right, I'll give it a shot. Peg, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going fishing this weekend. And every Saturday, when I take the garbage out, I throw away one of your shoes.
Well, you know, Al, I'm going to be honest with you, too. I knew you were going fishing. And at night, when you're sleeping, I pluck out your hair so you'll bald fast.
So Jefferson says that honesty is the best policy. So he says that, you know, you should never lie to your wife for one good reason, you know. And then he says, and yes, Marcy, what was that reason again?
like I'm going to say it, but I don't believe it.
So Sheila, so you're a married woman. So, you know, what's your perspective on this?
On what, the guy's going away for the weekend?
No, like I'd say like a little white lie.
I feel like honesty is always the best policy, but, you know, like, you still gotta have your secrets, I guess, every now and again. But if you're gonna go away for 3 days or whatever, I think you should be upfront and honest about it. But I'm also the type of person that I'm like, go with your friends, go do something. So I guess I'm a little bit different than Peg or even Marcy, but yeah, I don't know. It's not okay to lie to your partner, because ultimately something's gonna slip. And something's going to come out and you're just going to be like, I feel like the time that's elapsed from the time of the lie to the time that it's found out, like the explosion is bigger. So in the moment, it could have been like, yeah, we're just going to go fishing. Whereas if it's, you lied about it, and 3, 4, 5 months, even a year later, it blows up to be something bigger. So I think it's just better to be honest and you know, Marcy giving the incentives of telephoto lens. You know, I guess it's she's trying to win his love and affection and his trust.
Now, what do you think about that, Chris? I mean, you taking notes?
Yeah, I remember these. I mean, you know, small lies can lead to bigger lies. You know, I've just seen that in relationships. And then, you know, they lead to explosions later on. So...
I really love Al's line. He says, nobody wants to hear about your filthy chicken love.
And like the look of disgust on his face anytime he looks at Marcy is just so priceless.
Yeah. And that's like one of the tropes of the show. You know, it's like this, what's the word I'm looking for?
Well, it's like rivalry really for Jefferson's affection, right? It's she's monopolizing Jefferson and they get along well. And it's a give and take.
Well, I mean, really, I guess the point of the show is that, you know, Jefferson is a pretty boy who is a gold digger, right? So it's like he's with Marcy because she has money, you know, so he goes along as long as like, he gets something out of it, right? And he likes presents. I think that's sort of like the dynamic his relationship. But then the relationship with Al is more like, well, he's like sort of the buddy. It's like Al says out loud what most guys are thinking in their heads. And Jefferson goes along with it when Marcy's not around.
Yeah.
That's I'd say what the dynamic
is. Yeah, I'll agree with that.
And Jefferson himself says he knows that honesty goes against everything we guys stand for, but women eat it up.
I thought it was odd whenever Al said he throws away one of her shoes. I'm like, wouldn't that just make her shop even more? That'd just be like feeding the animal, so to speak, if you're throwing away your shoes, you know?
But her response was gold.
Yeah. She plucks his hairs at the making ball faster.
Like, those are the things about the show that I was just like, yes, that's what I'm here for.
Yeah, well, you know, to a bald guy, I don't like lines like that, right? And, you know, and
smarts right. Just a little extra, does it?
A little bit. Especially that I was already balding back then when this aired first run. I say, well, you know, and again, our patron saint of baldness, Dan Chase, should take offense to this. So, Sheila, I was one of the former co-hosts.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so now we cut to Al and Jefferson at the lodge.
On top of Old Smoky, all covered with snow, and everybody knew that.
Oh, God, I love this place, Al. It was a stroke of genius having me cash in Marcy's IRA to pay for this luxury vacation.
Now, when Al and Jefferson enter into the scene, they're singing a song. And the song is On Top of Old Smoky, which is a traditional folk song of the U.S. recorded by the Weavers, and it reached the top of the pop music charts in 1951.
So I'm going to tell you, as a 17-year-old, this probably flew right over my head. As a someone who's aged since then, cashing in an IRA, I'm like, ouch, that hurts. I just had to meet my financial planner last week because now it's time to talk about like where my risk assessment is. Like because of the age that I'm at. I'm like, oh, God. So that one hit a little close to home.
Well, I'm sitting here thinking, Marcy, you know, she's a bank manager. She must not pay very close to attention to her accounts because Jefferson's always cashing out her IRA, taking her credit card and using it. He does all types of things. And, like, you know, she usually catches him afterwards. But, dang, she needs to pay closer attention to her finances. You know?
And so much for honesty being the best policy as he's cashing out her IRA.
Right, right. He's being honest, but, you know, he's cashing out her IRA behind her back.
We are now presented with two very beautiful Swedish masseuses, and they are Inga and Helga.
Jefferson, would you stop taking pictures so we can enjoy this place? Jefferson, would you start taking pictures so we can enjoy this place?
Welcome in. We're your Swedish masseuses. I'm Helga, and I'm Inga.
And I'm Alga.
And I'm Gaga.
May we carry your bags?
Yes, may we carry yours?
Yeah, sure.
Jefferson, we died and went to the land of milk and honeys.
Inga is Shay Marks, and she was the Playboy Playmate of the Month in May of 1994.
Christy Shay Marks is an American model and actress, and as you said, she was the Playboy Playmate of the Month for May of 1994. She was discovered by Playboy photographer when she was 20 years old, and she was asked to pose for an advertisement for World Gym in Houston, Texas. I had no idea she was from Houston. That's funny. 1 month later, in October 1993, she flew to L.A., and she met her future husband on the flight and did a test shoot for a centerfold and was accepted for Playmate of the Month for 1994. And from the looks of it, she basically never looked back after that. She did shoots in Hong Kong and Denmark. She went on to appear in several Playboy special editions, including The Book of Lingerie, Girls of Summer, and Voluptuous Vixens.
And she has like 16 acting credits.
And I was just looking here for wrestling fans out there. She appeared in a wrestling WWF Monday Night Raw back in January of 22nd, 1996, as Triple H's valet during his match against Razor Ramon. You know, it's funny, I probably watched that match in all likelihood. I probably didn't make the connection that you know, was the girl from the Married with Children episode, but it was Monday night in 1996. Chances are I was watching Monday Night Raw.
And Donna Derrico, who plays Helga, was the Playboy Playmate of September 1995. So her issue of Playboy had just come out around the time that this episode aired.
Donna Jeanette Derrico is an American actress and model. She posed for Playboy as its Playmate of the Month for September 1995 and had a starring role on the television series Baywatch for 3 years. She is of Italian descent and continues to act in films and on television to this day, it says. She married Nikki Sixx.
He's the guitar player from Motley Crue.
That's right.
Okay, yeah, all right, there you go. You stole the words right out. Yeah, she married him, and it looks like she's lived in, she owned a day spa in Calabasas, California. And after leaving Baywatch, she appeared in independent films, including The Intervention, Inconceivable, The Making of Plus One, which was alongside Andy McDowell, Jennifer Tilly, Colm Feore, and Elizabeth McGovern. So this was perfect for both of them. I mean, it's great. It's great, you know, additional exposure for them.
No pun intended.
Ba-dum-bum.
Yeah, that's my favorite line in the entire episode, man, when Al goes, and I'm Alga. Just that look on his face when he says that. Ed O'Neill delivers that perfectly. And I'm Alga.
And they really play it up. In last week's episode, we had three women who had posed nude. So in this week's episode, we also have three women who posed nude. So this seems to be like a running theme in season 10. A lot of people sort of associate Married with Children with this type of, this kind of display.
Genre of publication, sure.
That's right. But the reality is that it wasn't as pronounced in the early seasons. Like we had, for example, Brandy Brandt, who appeared in, I guess that was season 3.
Yeah, that sounds right. And then we had Pamela Anderson, I think, first appeared in season 5, if I remember right, in the Al's Dream there.
Right, but like I said, this is like back to back to back to back. I mean, this is sort of, you know, one of the things about season 10, which is very different than the early seasons.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the thing is, you know, they sort of ham it up, I would say. You know, with these fake Swedish massages.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, they lean deep into the stereotype there.
Yeah. I'd be all for it with them as my masseuses. I'm just saying. I wouldn't be complaining.
Yeah, sure.
But would you be Alga or would you be Gaga?
I mean, she could call me whatever she wants. She can call me Alga. She can call me Gaga. She can call me Kaka if she wants. I don't care. If she's my masseuse, she can call me whatever she wants.
Yeah, definitely the land of milk and honey.
Yeah.
So Sheila, what's your opinion of this? It's like how do you view this as a woman? A scene like this.
Well, I mean, like I said it before, like I was like, yeah, they're really leaning deep into the stereotypes. Like they're not trying to. We know that they're not trying to further a narrative in any different direction other than to be like tongue-in-cheek funny and just to deliver, you know, some good comedy. So, you know, I take it on its face. Like, you know, yeah, they're going to lean into the stereotypes. They're Swedish, they're masseuses, they're named Helga and Inga. Like, I could have even predicted, like, once I'm Helga, I was like, that's going to be Inga. You know, because there's really no other, you know, name for, like, a stereotypical, you know, Swedish masseuse. But, yeah, it's just... You're, like I said before, like, you're going to watch this and you're going to, you know, take a certain tone with it. And, you know, for people who are going to get uptight about the stereotypes and things like that, it may not be a show for them. But like, Chris, like you said earlier, like, the men really take a beating in this show as well. Like, Al never gets the chance to win and Jefferson's always being put down by Marcy. So there's always this give and take back and forth. So, like, if you're going to look at it on its face, then it's... Is it a little condescending? Sure. But I mean, you're not coming into this, like I said, for the the highbrow intellectual culture. You're coming into this, you want to be entertained, you want to laugh. I forgot how many like joke a minute moments you get in this show. Like, that's what I come back to Married with Children for. Like, I come back for the zingers between Al and Peg and Bud and Kelly. Like, those dynamics, that's what I come back to it for. So it's not, you know, like, I mean, I could get very, like, hoity-toity and very feminist, but, like, that's not what I'm here for when I watch this show. Like, if I came across it and I didn't know anything about it, sure, I'd be pretty offended. But you also have to kind of take it in the pop culture context of the audience that it's playing to, the time frame that it was in as well. Like, you even said here, like, how much the show evolved in the, what, like, 8 seasons or 9 seasons that we're in now to this point, that the show did its evolution. So it's keeping up with the times as the times are changing. So you do have to give the show credit for that, too.
Yeah. You know, another thing, as I always say, each character on the show is, you know, like a gross exaggeration of the character, how it is in real life. I mean, you know, like Bud, for example, is a gross exaggeration of a, you know, a perverted high school / college kid that can't get laid. And Kelly is a gross exaggeration of like a blonde bimbo, basically. Well, this is a gross exaggeration of how two men would act if two Playboy Playmates walked up to them and said that they were their masseuses, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's all I take from this scene.
Also want to point out that Al is wearing a sweater that he wore in Season 7, Episode 14. It doesn't get any better than this. It says, "I fish, therefore I am." And this is a spoof on Rene Descartes' famous declaration of "I think, therefore I am." And I was on that podcast episode with Alex and Dan Chase back in Season 7. So now we're introduced to the character of Randolph.
Mr. Bundy and Mr. Darcy. I'm Randolph the innkeeper, and I've been trying to get a hold of you. There's been a slight change in your cabin assignment.
What's the change?
You don't have one.
That's okay. We'll bunk in with Helga and Inga.
Yes, sir.
Helga, Inga, you're late for topless happy hour.
Yes, yes, sir.
Hey, look, you can't bump us. See, we made our reservation over a year ago.
So you did. Let me explain something. You're nobodies, and you had a reservation. Shannon Tweed is a famous actress. She didn't have a reservation. Explanation over.
Shannon Tweed? Star of Night Eyes 2, Night Eyes 3, and every fantasy I've ever had since I got cable?
You know, Shannon Tweed got me through many a long, lonely night of sex with Marcy.
And Randolph is played by Joey Seagal, who is Katie Seagal's brother.
I was wondering that when you said that in the beginning, that who like the guest stars were. I was like, it has to be some relation, but it wasn't apparent in the show.
So now we've seen, so I had it in my notes here. So now we've seen Katie Seagal's brother. We've seen David Faustino's brother twice. And we've seen Ed O'Neill's wife twice.
Christina Applegate's mother.
Oh, was Christina Applegate's mother in this too? What
yes.
What was that?
She was in the episode when Al wanted to get the car. Remember, like, he's pleading with the guy. He's like, please. It's like, I'll be your son.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
I'm trying to remember. I'm thinking it's probably around Season 5.
Okay. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I know the episode you're talking about. Yeah. So that's what I put in my notes. I was like, have we seen any of Christina Applegate's family? And I'm trying to figure out if we've seen any, you know, of Amanda Burse or Ted McGinley, David Garrison.
Oh no, we did actually see Ted McGinley's wife. She was in a bank. She was in the bank. There was an episode when Jefferson is like pinching the butt of a girl who's filling out a deposit slip at the bank. And when I looked at it, I figured out that it was like Alex said, like, look at this, like, you know, it was like pinching the butt, and then I recognized it. And his wife is, I believe her name is Gigi Rice.
Right. Okay. Awesome.
It's cool how much they keep it in the family, so to speak.
Yeah, definitely.
Randolph tells Alan Jefferson that they no longer have a reservation because Shannon Tweed has taken it. So Al gets very excited. She's the star of Night Eyes 2, Night Eyes 3, and every fantasies he's ever had since he got cable. And we know that that hasn't been for a long time because Al generally doesn't pay for anything or he steals cable from someone, right?
But he knows what he likes.
So there's this line that Randolph says about how he's trying to get a hold of Alan Jefferson. So think about it. 1995, you know, what percentage of the population had cell phones? I mean, Chris, you and I have spoken about that.
In 1995, I mean, I would say probably 10, 15% tops. That's probably being generous.
I had a cell phone in 1995. I had like this big Motorola brick thing with a flip out, a flip top that went over the keypad. My mom made a deal. She was like, listen, if you're going to drive around, you need to have a cell phone. I was like, okay. But I was only allowed to use it in dire emergencies because it was like $12,000 a nanosecond.
And those films that they mentioned, Night Eyes 2 and Night Eyes 3, are real films of Shannon. There's a film that she does, that a fake film that she mentions later, but we'll talk about it when we get there.
Yeah.
In comes Shannon Tweed.
Oh, Randolph.
Yes, Miss Tweed.
Are those the two gentlemen that had reservations for my cabin?
Yes, Miss Tweed.
Oh, good. I did so want to meet them.
I told you she'd straighten this thing out, just like she straightened out Andrew Stevens in Night Eyes 3.
Yeah, well, just as I thought. A mangy shoe salesman and a chronically unemployed aging pretty boy. Have them thrown off the property immediately.
Jeez, I can't believe she said that.
Me either. Aging? Now, Redford, that's aging.
And Shannon Tweed was born March 10th, 1957. She's a Canadian actress and model. One of the most successful actresses of mainstream erotica. She's identified with the genre of the erotic thriller. Tweed lives with her husband, Gene Simmons, bassist and co-lead singer of the band Kiss, and their two children, Nicholas and Sophie. Shannon Tweed is also known for the Gene Simmons Family Jewels, a television reality show that portrayed the life of her family from 2006 to 2012. And here's another little tidbit. Gene Simmons and Katie Sagal once dated.
Interesting.
It's also interesting that that Shannon and Katie Sagal don't share a scene.
Talk about keeping it in the family.
That's pretty funny.
So what did you think of her performance on that opening scene?
I thought it was pretty good. I mean, she's obviously playing the part of a rich celebrity who is happy that she holds the power to be able to kick two regular guys out. Basically, she took her spot and she's kind of reveling in it in a way. She's like, hey, just as I suspected, a shoe salesman and an aging pretty boy. Have them escorted off the property immediately, you know?
Yeah, it's really reinforcing that stereotype about celebrities just being crass when they can and getting away with it. Like,
Yeah, she played it really well, I think, you know?
I like that she calls him a mangy shoe salesman. I thought that was funny. And then when she calls Jefferson an aging playboy, he's like, no, Redmond. Redford. Yeah.
Well, I liked it. I thought it was funny how she could tell he was a shoe salesman just by looking at him. Like, no one even told her. She's like, just as I suspected, a mangy shoe salesman. She could tell that within 5 seconds of seeing him.
Yeah. And Jefferson takes offense about being a chronically unemployed aging pretty boy.
Yeah. He's really just upset about the aging part.
Right.
Yeah. And again, playing to the stereotype, right?
Right.
So Sheila, what's your opinion on that? I mean, Robert Redford was considered one of, you know, the hunks of Hollywood. So I don't know, would you consider him maybe your style?
I can appreciate him, but I don't know if he's necessarily, I never found him as devastatingly handsome as other people did. I'm trying to think of like what's a contemporary movie to this time. Would it be maybe like Indecent Proposal or something like that? Yeah, he's a handsome dude, but I wouldn't necessarily equate him with like the playboy that Jefferson equates himself to.
Okay.
I would probably pick somebody a little more like Paul Newman. Like if you said Paul Newman, I'd be like, yes, that is like an aging fox.
Okay. All right. No.
It's personal preference though.
They make a mentions to Andrew Stevens, who was co-star on Night Eyes 3, which was correct. I've never seen the film. But according to Wikipedia, Andrew Stevens is an American executive film producer, director, and actor, born 1955. Now, Shannon Tweed in this scene is 38 years old. I mean, I have to admit, she looks phenomenal. In terms of her stats, she's 5'10". Now, Ed O'Neill is about 6'1". So you can sort of see, like, later on, especially, like, when they're, like, at the same level. I mean, she's probably wearing heels, but she's a very tall girl.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, gentlemen, just to show you I'm not entirely without feeling, here's your deposit back.
And here are your complimentary mints.
I suggest Mr. Bundy have them both. And you have exactly 2 minutes to get off the premises. Good day.
Now, I think to me, like, one of the funniest lines of this whole episode is when Randolph kicks Alan Jefferson out, and he says, you know, just to show that I'm entirely without feeling, here's your deposit back. And here are your complimentary mints, and I suggest Mr. Bundy have both of them.
Poor Al. And like the look on his face, he's just stung.
Yeah. It's almost like a look of confusion, but I thought it was like hysterical.
Like he took more offense to the breath mint than he did to being called a mangy shoe salesman.
Right.
Oh, God.
Now, who the hell does he think he is? He can't throw us out of here.
Well, I'm afraid he can, Al. Private property.
I'll show him some private property.
Al decides to pee, and Jefferson starts snapping some pictures, and we have to set this up for the next scene where we see them together.
Oh, I was just going to say, it's so funny how when Jefferson starts taking those pictures, it looks like he's taking photos of Al taking a piss.
It really does.
I'm like Jefferson.
I was a little confused for the time.
I'm like, what are you
doing? And he had like a big grin on his face, too, while he was doing it.
Yeah, he was all happy.
It's time for no man to take a little break in the jiggly room. I'm the DJ, and I'm gonna play a little bit of music that was on this week's episode of Marry with Children.
On top of a smoky, all covered with snow, I lost my true lover.
Our parting's a pleasure.
Our parting's a pleasure.
So now we cut back to the Bundy living room with Bud and Lucky.
Lucky, if you're going to be in this commercial, you're going to have to learn to sit. Now sit!
I'll never teach this dog how to sit. What am I going to have to do, beg? Kelly, I cannot get this dog to do what I want him to.
Well, maybe you need a rubber dog. Here, let me try. I'll show him by example. All right, Lucky, sit.
Kelly, please, that's never gonna work. I've already tried doing all that.
Come on, Lucky, let's go outside and I'll teach you some more tricks.
Give me a bone with some meat on it. I'll jump over the house.
Nobody really notices that Lucky knows how to do, you know, follow commands. It's like, you know, sit, beg, etc.
Yeah, that was funny.
So then Kelly walks in and says that, well, maybe, Bud, you need a rubber dog. Yeah.
If it was rubber, Bud can make him do whatever he wants to do, huh?
Yeah. Moving right along. Al and Jefferson come in, and they discover that there's some pictures in their collection that they didn't see before.
So getting bumped from the fishing cabin wasn't all that bad, was it, Al?
Well, nothing drowns your sorrows better than a 3-day binge at the nudie bar.
Oh, wow. Look at this picture I took of the lake. Here's the lodge. Here's a nudie bar.
Wait a second, Jefferson. We didn't take any pictures at the nudie bar.
Yeah, you're right. And the nudie bar isn't in the woods. And it doesn't have Shannon Tweed and Randolph in the hot tub.
Holy Moses, Jefferson, do you know what this means?
Yeah, Cosby's right. Kodak paper does make a difference.
Now, Al talks about having a 3-day binge at the nudie bar.
As you do.
So, I mean, I guess they decided it'd be better to spend their money at the nudie bar than come home. So what did you think about that, Chris?
Oh, that was funny. I'm like, they just had an extended stay at the nudie bar. I mean, that's better than going home to their wives, you know?
Well, I mean, they already got the free pass for the weekend. They're not going to go home. I agree.
That's true. I mean, why would you, you know?
You know, Al's already been caught in his lie and been outed by Jefferson. So might as well make the best of it.
Right. Definitely.
Can I interrupt for 1 second? So this is something that I was laughing at when I was watching it. So something that came out in 1995, we're watching it now in 2021. Things that people either have forgotten were a thing or will never know. Waiting to develop your pictures.
Yeah, yeah. I had that in my notes too.
Yep. So, you know, the photo mat and, you know, what they're making reference to, the line specifically is, you know, Cosby's right. Kodak does make a difference. There were a series of commercials in the 80s and 90s starring Bill Cosby.
Where, are we allowed to talk about Bill Cosby?
Yeah, well, I mean, we can. No, I think, you know, we just talk about it as part of that was just the culture of the time. I mean, obviously.
He was normal back then, we promise.
Well, I mean.
At least we thought he was normal.
But yeah, I mean, during this time period, you know, Bill Cosby hawked everything from Jell-O to Kodak. He used to
pudding pops. Yeah, yeah.
He had back in the 80s. He did commercials for E.F. Hutton. So you know, he was a very popular spokesperson during this time period.
Do you ever look at the other side of your pictures? You have any idea what's back here? Now, here's what should be back here. It should say Kodak on the back because Kodak paper means Kodak quality. And the best way to get Kodak quality here is to look for the Kodak color watch seal where you get your film developed. Now, you got no Kodak paper back here, no color watch seal here. No seal? Who knows? Make sure you check the back. I asked for jumbo prints, but this is ridiculous.
I really liked that show he did, Kids Say the Darndest Things. Did you ever watch that?
Absolutely.
With him, that was hilarious.
Yeah, I remember watching The Cosby Show when it first came out, first run. I mean, that was 1982. I was 4 years old. And I remember watching the pilot episode with my sister. I have a sister who's 4 years older than me. You know, so, I mean, again, you know, I remember like Fat Albert. You know, watching like that in cartoons,
yeah.
You know, back
yeah.
That time. So, I mean, Cosby has been part of our lives, you know, for
our pop culture, you know, lives
for a really long time.
Our entire lives.
I mean,
yeah.
it's unfortunate what's happened recently. You know, what's come out recently.
Yeah, I mean, like the night before I went in to have my son, I knew I was going to be induced on a Friday, and so the night before we watched Bill Cosby himself. I mean, this is 2013 before things came out about him, but it was just such a funny comedic performance about, you know, being a parent and sort of the way in which they change your life. Like that, we quoted that for years until, you know, it can be a thing that you don't talk about anymore. But yeah, like he's an important part of like where we grew up and a lot of our references come from.
So we discover that Shannon Tweed is having a tryst with Randolph.
You idiot! It's payback time. Nobody bumps us, baby. Shannon Tweed is about to get bumped herself right onto the front page of the National Enquirer. Yes.
The National Enquirer is an American tabloid newspaper published by American Media. Founded in 1926, the newspaper has undergone a number of changes over the years. The National Enquirer openly acknowledges that it will pay sources for tips, a practice which is generally disapproved by the mainstream press. It has also been embroiled in several controversies related to its catch-and-kill practices and allegations of blackmail.
So Sheila's going to laugh when I say this. So one of my cousins worked for American Media. and Sheila knows I have lots of relatives, so this is another one of them. But yeah, you know, from what I remember, like, I got tipped off that J-Lo was having twins back in the day. I mean, I'm sure Alex would have wanted to have known that info if I had known him at that point in time. But yeah, you know, they are headquartered in New York City, and say it's a staple in the supermarket aisles here in the U.S.
Oh, absolutely. Whenever I'm going through the line at Walmart or HEB or Target, I always look just to see what it is, see what the, you know, National Enquirer says. I mean, a lot of times it's nonsense, but sometimes it turns out to be true.
Boy, look at this picture of Shannon Tweed Jefferson. Isn't she a babe?
Ah, come on, Al. I'll bet our wives in this beautiful mountain setting with the steam rising up off the hot tub would look just as good.
No way! Jefferson, how much do you think this picture of Shannon Tweed is worth to the tabloids?
Well, let's see. Your typical celebrity nude photo brings in, oh, say, upwards of $1,000. But see, in this case, it's a celebrity doing the Humpty dance with the help. That's got to fetch at least $10,000.
Yeah, you see, but Jefferson, even though we did get bumped from our cabin, I mean, this is a little heartless and cold, huh? Even for us. Huh?
Yeah, you're right, Al. You know, the honest thing to do would be just throw this away and pretend like it never happened. Huh?
You got it.
All right. Just, hey. Well, you feel better about yourself now?
Much. Yeah. I'll see you later, buddy. You know, I think since Peg's not home, it's probably safe to go up there and take a little nap. Yeah.
Marcy is home, so I think I'll go back to the nudie bar.
Later, buddy.
Back at you, pal o' mine.
You the man.
Oh, no. No. You the man.
Now, here's the funny thing. There's this phrase that they do. This is when they go to throw out the picture in the negative. So Al and Jefferson say, it's like, back at you, pal of mine. I mean, that sounds like that's like an Ed Norton line from The Honeymooners. That's one. And then you the man. It's like, oh, no, you the man. Now, as I recall, that was the catchphrase of around that period of time, correct?
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly where it comes from at this point, but I do remember that that was one of those catchphrases around 1995.
Yeah, I remember saying that. I mean, you know. And something still people still say to this day. They're like, you the man. No, you the man.
All right. I mean, so for any of our listeners, if you remember where that comes from, why don't you comment on that in our posts? Okay, so now we cut to the set of a dog food commercial.
Next.
How dare you reject my dog? He's Eddie on Frasier, you know.
Ma'am, Eddie is a Jack Russell Terrier. Your mutt is a near-blind bulldog.
Well, he looks different in person. You're in the business. You know the camera adds 15 pounds.
Yeah, and so are those donuts you stuffed in your purse during the audition. Now get out.
Let's go, Eddie.
We have a woman whose name is, I believe this is... Mary Harper Jones, who plays the stage mom, with her near-blind bulldog.
Yeah, she calls him Eddie.
Right. Says that he's Eddie on Frasier. Now, the director is one of our favorite directors, and he's played by Leland Orser. He was on a previous episode that Chris and I reviewed, The Naked, the Dead, but Mostly the Naked in Season 8. Mm-hmm. And he will also appear on Kiss of the Coffee Woman later on in the series.
Yeah, he's really good at playing that role, just the, like, really sarcastic director that hates his job, so to speak, or, like, sort of dreads his job and just kind of snaps at people, you know. He's really good at that. Moose was a Jack Russell Terrier who portrayed Eddie Crane on the American sitcom Frasier. It says Moose's son Enzo took over as Eddie from about season 8 onwards.
Yeah, so, and Frasier is a famous NBC show which continued the story of Dr. Frasier Crane, which originated in Cheers.
And that dog, Moose, by the way, was almost 16 years old when it passed away. Had a long life.
Because that's what they say, right? I mean, the smaller the dog, I guess the longer the life. Like a bigger dog has a shorter life.
Yeah.
Yeah, generally, yeah, they say the smaller dogs will outlive the bigger ones.
Now, you know, even the director has these biting lines, you know. I mean, the woman says he looks different in person. It says, you know, the camera adds 15 pounds. Cindy says, and so do the donuts you stuffed in your purse during the audition.
Jeez, you think there'd be one half-starved mongrel in this town that can make it through this obstacle course?
Lucky can do it.
Oh, yeah? And I suppose he plays Murray on Mad About You?
Oh, no, he hates Paul Reiser.
In that case, I'll give him a shot.
So when Bud Kelly and Lucky come in, he says, you know, who's this guy supposed to be? I suppose he plays Murray on Mad About You.
I thought this was a really great line for Kelly to come in and be like, oh, no, he hates Paul Reiser. She was really quick on the uptake there. So that was a good use of her intelligence there.
Yeah, very quick-witted.
Yes.
Yeah, the Buckman's dog Murray was actually Maui, a collie mix. He was originally found in a Castaic, California animal shelter by a Hollywood animal trainer. Maui got his start in TV commercials and as the understudy for titular circus dog in Bingo back in 1991. Mad About You is an American sitcom television series starring Paul Reiser and Helen Hunt as a married couple in New York City. The series focuses mainly on newlyweds Paul Buckman and documentary filmmaker and Jamie Stemple Buckman, a public relations specialist, as they deal with everything from humorous daily minutiae to major struggles. Near the end of the show's run, they have a baby daughter whom they name Mabel.
Yeah. So you guys remember that show?
I do. I didn't really care for it, but...
Yeah, same.
Okay.
I don't know, it was just on at a time where I don't think that the humor really pertained to me. It was, yeah, I think the humor was a little more adult for what I was consuming, I think, at the time. What year did it come out, Luigi?
Let's see.
It was in the 90s, for
oh,
sure.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Let's get the, came out in 92 through 99.
Yeah, so like, I mean, we were 92, we were, what, 14 years old?
Yeah, freshman in high school.
Yeah,
almost so through the end of our junior year of college.
Yeah, so but by the time that it ended, I definitely wasn't paying any attention to it. But when it first came out, it just wasn't something for me. But whereas Married with Children had, you know, obviously adult themes and whatnot, but it was still like a different level of humor, which attracted, you know, people of our age group, I think, at that time.
Yeah, you know, Married with Children, I'd say, and I've talked about this on the podcast before, has two layers of comedy. There's a slapstick layer that is very visual, you know, and it's almost like that setup joke, and it's very silly. And then there's a very sophisticated humor layer that sits above it that, you know, occasionally comes out. You know, it's like there are times where they're quoting like Shakespeare, you know, or they're quoting like high culture, you know, to make a low culture joke, right? And
well, like the, sorry to interject, but like the René Descartes, I think, therefore I am, I fish, therefore I am. You know, you have to be, you know, sort of savvy to make that connection, to make that funny.
That's right. I mean, like this whole interchange with, you know, Bud Kelly and the director. I mean, like that's like a high culture. Like, because think about it. It's like you have to be watching television. And it's like, well, he says he hates Paul Reiser, you know, making this connection to Mad About You. I mean, I think that's funny because it's instead of saying it's like, oh, you know, you're. You know, Peg, your mother is enormous, right? And making a joke like that way. Like here it is. It's like he's making a joke about a specific, like some other TV show. And usually they took jabs at other popular TV shows that followed the classic format, And what we call it, Sheila, is, you know, a lot of TV shows of the 70s and 80s and early 90s were morality plays where they're trying to teach the audience a lesson, right? So going back to, let's say, All in the Family or the Jeffersons, it's like, well, you know, we want to talk about racism, sexism, and all that, and do it in a funny way, but we want to teach you a lesson. And, you know, that continued into the 80s with all of these family sitcoms where it's like
Growing Pains, right, and Family Ties.
That's right. Father knows best and mother knows best, and the children have some bad friends, and occasionally they try to hold them astray. And Married with Children instead was the show about the bad friends.
You know? Yep. How the other half lives.
Correct. You know, where father doesn't know best and mother doesn't know best, and the children are those bad kids that you don't want your kids hanging out with.
Right, they're left to fend for themselves, really.
Right.
Hungry Puppy Dog Food Audition number 2073, take one.
Now, run the course. Oh, come on, Lucky. Just get into character. Be a hungry puppy.
Oh, there's a stretch.
Come on, Lucky. Now you want to be in the commercial and make lots of money?
Well, I know how this works. I get in the commercial, you get the money, I end up sharing a jail cell with a cast of Different Strokes.
Next.
The director is very sarcastic. He says, Hungry Puppy Dog Food Audition number 2073. So he's a little sick of doing auditions, right?
Yep.
You know, and Lucky gets another zinger in there, right? And he talks about he's going to end up sharing a jail cell with the cast of Different Strokes. So do you remember that, Sheila, like what they're talking about there?
I do. So the stars of the show were routinely getting themselves into a whole heap of legal trouble, usually with drugs. Am I correct?
Yeah, that's right. So Todd Bridges and Dana Plato. That's right.
Yeah. And didn't both of them die?
Dana Plato died. Todd Bridges is still alive.
Oh, okay. But I knew that they themselves had multiple run-ins with the police and drug overdoses and things like that.
Yeah, it was Gary Coleman who passed away.
That's right, yeah. So it was Dana Plato and Gary Coleman who passed away. But Todd Bridges and Dana Plato were always in trouble. They were on the cover of the National Enquirer an awful lot.
It was very tragic, you know, for Dana Plato. You know, she really, like, took it hard. I mean, I'm very glad that Todd Bridges was able to clean himself up.
Yeah, but it's also, like, really hard, I think, for child actors to kind of navigate in this very adult world where things are being thrown at them, and if they don't have good role models and supports around them, that's the road that's tragically so many of them go down.
Say, we actually get to see Gary Coleman here in the series, I think twice, right?
Yeah, we see him in the season finale this season.
Yeah, it's kind of cool.
So Lucky wants some motivation and doesn't want to run the obstacle course.
No, wait, he can do it, I promise. He just needs a little motivation. Just watch and follow me.
What?
It's good. Oh.
Well, that was great. The auditions are over. We have our hungry puppy.
Kelly shows him what to do, and it appears that Lucky has the commercial. Now we cut to the Bundy living room, and an auction is underway.
Thank you. There you go. Have a seat. Thanks very much. Attention, media whores. I mean, esteemed members of the press. The auction for the Shannon Tweed hot tub photo is about to begin.
All right, we'll show us the good time. All in good time.
I like how they say, you know, attention media whores. I mean, esteemed members of the press.
Get that little dig in there.
They really are. I mean, how many times have we seen the press in the Bundy household? I mean, just over the years, that'd be something funny to count. How many times, you know, Luigi, like if you were to start all the way with season one and come to the present.
Well, I think in this one in particular, back in season 9, we had the episode Ship Happens. So we saw all of them in there. Now, the person missing in this scene is Teresa Parente as Miranda Veracruz de la Hoya Cardinal. She should have been in that. She should have been in that room.
Yeah, I wonder why she's not there.
Yeah, and we would love to have her on our podcast. We could, that would be a question we would ask her. It's like, why weren't you there? Like, you know, you would have added a lot of comedic value to that scene.
Yep.
Yeah. So what, Sheila? You laughed that I could say it without stuttering.
No, just the lyrical way that it just rolled off your tongue, like you've practiced it 100 times.
Well, it's my musical training, right?
Before I get to the main event, however, I would like to start with a genuine picture of the Loch Ness Monster.
Well, let's see it. Come on, show us in here.
My God, Al, that's horrific. What the hell is it?
It's a picture of Peg's mom in the bathtub.
I don't see a bathtub in there.
Trust me, Jefferson, it's under there somewhere.
That's not the Loch Ness Monster. He's not that big.
So what? We slap Roseanne's head on it and say she lost weight. I'll give you $50.
So Al wants to auction off a picture of Peg's mom.
Well, he's going to do a test balloon, right? He wants to see what, you know, the how the fish are biting, so to speak. You know, bring, to take that metaphor a little deeper there.
That's not the Loch Ness Monster, man. He's not that big.
So I sold it for $50. Like, we'll slap Roseanne's head on and say she lost weight. Ooh. Yeah, they love taking digs at Roseanne, by the way.
Yeah.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, for the main event, Shannon Tweed, as you've never seen her before. Now, we will start the bidding at...
$1,000.
I get $1,000 here. Do I hear more?
$3,000.
Oh, come on. You pay twice that much for Brett Butler pulling out her wedgie. Come on.
I'll give you $5,000.
Make it $10,000.
$10,000. Here we have $10,000 going once, $10,000 going twice. So close to a sale.
Make it $12,500.
Jefferson, keep the fleecing going. If I'm not back, you send my mail to King Al, Hammock 1, Isle of Yap.
Okay, 12-5, right?
So now we start with the auction of the Shannon Tweed photo. And we get it gets up to about $10,000, and then it becomes $12,500, and the doorbell rings.
So close to being sold.
Yeah.
Yep.
So there's a great line here, right? You could send them my mail to King Al, Hammock 1, Isle of Yap. So Yap traditionally refers to an island group located in the Caroline Islands of the Western Pacific Ocean, a part of Yap State. The name Yap in recent years has also come to refer to the state within the Federated States of Micronesia, inclusive of the Yap main islands and its various outer islands. There's also a reference to Brett Butler, who is an American actress, writer, and stand-up comedian, and she's known for playing the title role of the ABC comedy series Grace Under Fire. Well, because you pay twice that much for Brett Butler pulling out a wedgie. So, I don't know. Do you guys remember that?
I remember that show, but, I mean, it was like, you know, her 15 minutes of fame kind of thing. I don't remember it being very long-lived. I mean, I think I watched a few episodes, but it wasn't, like, something I ran for.
Same. I don't remember a scandal of her pulling a wedgie out of her butt either.
Yeah, no scandals.
Was that something maybe she did on the show?
I don't know.
No, that was probably her, you know, going into 7-Eleven or something like that and picking out her wedgie.
Yeah, I mean, that for them to put that in there, that probably actually happened. Some dummy, some loser probably took a picture of her pulling a wedgie and someone bought it for $1,000.
Yeah.
Yeah, so she has... I mean, her show, Grace Under Fire, was contemporaneous with Married with Children. It ran from 1993 to 1998.
It was on for that long? Wow.
So now we get this totally improbable scene where Shannon Tweed is at Al Bundy's front door.
Yeah!
Shannon Tweed here in my house?
Mr. Bundy, I know you're going to find this hard to believe, but... I came by to apologize for the way I treated you at the lodge.
Now, you know, I can believe Brandy Brandt showing up in the shoe store. right?
Yeah.
But, you know, how is it that Shannon Tweed ends up in Al's front door?
Yeah, I mean, how the hell would she even know where he lived? I mean, this was before the days that nowadays, you know, you can look up anyone, just look up the tax records, but there was no internet back then. I guess there was, but not the internet that we have now.
No, it was AOL yeah. online, friend. It was chat right. rooms.
Yeah, like, how the hell would she know where to go?
Netscape Navigator, you know.
I guess we could say, well, Randolph knows their address since they booked the cabin through them.
Yeah, but, well, initially I was like, when Luigi first mentioned it about, you know, how would they get the address, I was like, maybe from the photos that Jefferson had to develop?
Yeah.
Because you usually had to give, well, like, an address and a phone number.
No, right? I think probably word got out that there was an auction was going on. So she probably got tipped off. That's how, like, I mean, if you have to make logical sense out of it, that seems to be the only way that it would yeah. be possible.
Right.
The other question I had in my notes is, why would she really care? If she's a pornographic actress, why would she care about a nude photo? I mean, I guess if she's making out with someone that she doesn't want anybody to know about, I suppose, but...
Yeah, well, no, she's not a pornographic actress. Like, you know, effectively what she does is she... you would almost call it, I guess, softcore in the sense that, you know, she's nude, but it's not explicit.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I thought she was actually like a full-blown.
Yeah, and I think it really has to do with the fact that, you know, she's having an affair. Now, mind you, you know, based on her biography, she only got married to Gene Simmons in 2011, but she'd been together with him since 1983. So it's like, again, to try to put some sense into this world that we've created, it's like it would be scandalous for her to be seen with someone else.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I got you. Okay, makes sense.
Here is Shannon Tweed in front of Al Bundy's front door.
Well, I apology accepted. I gotta go now. Bye.
Oh no, Mr. Bundy, wait. Look, you know, being a famous actress, I guess I've gotten used to having my own way, and well, I might have forgotten that other people have feelings too. But without those people. I'm not a famous star. I'm just an average woman.
So, you know, she seems very genuine, don't you think, in terms of, like, how she feels sorry about how she treated him?
Yeah, I don't know. To me, it was obvious that she was going to burn him. She wanted that picture one way or the other, and she was going to burn him. But, yeah, I can see what you're saying. What'd you think, Sheila? Was it obvious to you?
Well, yes, because you know what the payoff is going to be, that Al's never going to, you know, get the trophy at the end, right? So you know that, yeah. like, he's being set up. But for what she wanted to accomplish, I think that she delivered the lines that she wanted to have him believe.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, definitely.
No, but I would say it's like, you know, definitely her acting. I mean, it's like a lot of times you get people on Married with Children who are playing themselves and, like, they ham it up. They over-exaggerate yeah. themselves. We had, for example, Wolfman Jack, or we had Gilbert Gottfried back in season 9. And we've had, you know, people who play themselves. And again, like, they're playing to the camera. Like, to me, she actually seemed, like, almost sincere. Like, you know, she didn't seem like she was trying to ham it up. When in the initial scene when she's in front of the cabin, yes. But in this scene, it's like she seems a little more authentic. So, I mean, I have to give her credit for that.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah, definitely.
I watched a lot of The Family Jewels when it was on. I'm generally allergic to reality TV, but I did enjoy that show. And seeing her in that show, in their life, yes, part of it is put on, but you still do see their regular interactions. And that part of this show, where she's talking to Al on the stoop, it did feel like more of the authentic Shannon that you came to know in the reality show. So I thought this was really like a true to herself kind of a portrayal, whereas the beginning part was like this put on element about her character or about a persona. But yeah, like she was definitely a little bit more believable until she, you know, had her Hollywood self come out on him. I felt bad for him.
With way above average Hooters.
Well, thank you. God and Dr. Markowitz have been kind. Anyway, I felt so bad after I got home that I, I talked it over with my shrink, my herbalist, the counter boy at Starbucks, and they all agreed. Shannon, you're a taker, they said. You've got to start giving.
Well, you were giving pretty good in that shower scene and indecent behavior.
Well, thank you, but that was acting. This is real.
So Al, so she says that she's just an average woman, and Al says with way above average hooters. I guess that's where his mind always goes, huh?
Yeah.
But hey, but she was honest. She said, you know, it's not all her doing.
Yeah, God and Dr. Markowitz. So actually, I did look this up. You're going to laugh. I wanted to see if there was a Dr. Markowitz who was a plastic surgeon.
Oh, stop.
In,
is there?
In Beverly Hills, and yes, there is.
Of course there is.
That's cool. I mean, I bet you he really appreciated, or he or she really appreciated, you know, getting the plug there on national television.
I'm not sure if it's the same one, but I'm just saying, like I just said, you know, Dr. Markowitz, I figured, you know, she lives in Beverly Hills, right? And sure enough, I found one. And also, you know, one of the things is, Sheila, they love these tropes. So, like, if you're going to have a plastic surgeon, it's probably going to be a Markowitz.
Yeah.
You know?
It's going to be something very stereotypical.
That's right. Yeah. It's not going to be Dr. Luigi.
Right, yeah. Yeah, the likelihood of a Dr. McGann is going to be far lower on that totem pole.
No. A bartender named Dr. McGann, though, right?
Yeah, so, yeah, definitely. You know, definitely.
Again, playing to the stereotypes.
The stereotypes, exactly.
Yeah. So here's another funny line. You know, she said, you know, she talked it over with her shrink, her herbalist, and the counter boy at Starbucks. Yeah, and that seems to, like, play into, again, the stereotype of, like, you know, these Hollywood types who, you know, they have this entourage of people who really they shouldn't be talking to, right? I mean, maybe the shrink, I believe, but the herbalist and the counter boy at Starbucks, I mean, well, again, plays up to some of those stereotypes.
But I mean, like, good on them for being, like, you know, in tune with the pop culture. Like, you know, your counter boy at Starbucks, it's somebody you would see pretty much every day. So, yeah, she might run stuff past him. Who knows?
And, you know, and the other thing is, you know, I give Shannon Tweed and anyone else credit on this episode in the sense that we know that they know that they're hamming it up and they know that they're almost making fun of themselves or, like, these fictional versions of themselves. So you have to give them credit for, like, going along for the joke. Right, because, I mean, some...
Yeah, mm-hmm. Being a good sport.
Yeah, I mean, like, some people wouldn't... that would be offended by that. I mean, obviously, for them to be on the show, they can't be offended by it. But, you know, not everyone always likes that.
Right, there'd be some pushback if they were really of a certain mind.
Shannon appears to try to seduce Al.
If I only knew that I reached you in some way, I'd feel so much better about myself.
Oh, you've reached me.
God, you're so sexy if you weren't married.
Oh, I'm not married. No, I live alone with my redheaded mother.
Oh, what am I talking about? There I go, selfishly giving in to my insatiable lust for you.
Insatiable lust? For me?
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's understandable. You know, I played a little high school ball.
It really shows.
Using her wily ways to get what she wants.
Yeah.
You know, there's an old saying, God gave men two heads, but only enough blood to fill, only enough blood to use one head at a time or something
like
that.
Yeah, to fuel one at a time, yeah.
Right, yeah. This is a perfect example. Al was... seconds away from getting $10,000, actually $12,000, $12,500.
Yeah, when he
and
walked out.
He goes out there and he completely loses his head. He completely loses, you know, loses composure and just forgets about the money. He actually thinks she really wants to seduce him, you know?
Yeah, but he's not married. No, I'm not married. I live with my redheaded mother.
Like, and I totally think this, like, you know, again, we talked about gross exaggeration. This is a gross exaggeration of men, but, like, I feel like a woman would never fall for this. Like, if a woman, like, if you were to flip the roles here, a woman would not be this stupid and would not be dumb enough to fall for this, you know? If she had $12,500 in the bank, she would cash that ticket. She wouldn't go out and let the, you know, the other person seduce her. You know what I'm saying? Trying to say here?
Yeah, yeah.
This is totally something a guy would fall
like,
for. You know?
I smell a rat. Yeah.
Right. There's no way. Like, there's no way a woman would fall for this. I'm just saying.
Well, he mentions that he played a little high school ball.
He was probably about to mention that he scored 4 touchdowns in 1 game, but she cut him off.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, God. She says it really shows.
Shannon, you may not understand what I'm about to do, but always remember that I do this for you.
Al, what are you doing with that envelope? Did you swallow that whole thing?
Yep.
So he takes that envelope with the picture and the negative, and he folds it up and puts it in his mouth. Now, you know, I would have liked to have seen that as be like for him to really have eaten it, so for the camera to have stayed on him, right, where he swallows, but they cut that. You know, they cut away to her face and then back to him, so now he doesn't have that thing folded in his mouth, right? So now Shannon shows her hand.
It looked like there was a photograph in it.
Yeah.
Of me in a hot tub?
Yeah.
You. Blue collar, brown panted, shoe-selling yokel. Despite what Siskel and Ebert say, I am quite an accomplished actress, as you so clearly demonstrated today. So the next time you want to see me in a hot tub, you rent my upcoming straight-to-video classic, Ernest Pays for Sex. And don't forget to rewind.
Yeah. I like how she says, you know, you blue-collar, brown-pants, shoe-selling yokel.
It was the brown pants again. It was like, you're getting very particular, very, you know, down into the weeds to insult this guy. Back to the mangy shoe salesman, you know?
And I actually looked up, just because I hear the word yokel a lot, but I didn't know the true definition. A yokel is an uneducated and unsophisticated person from the countryside. So, yeah, being called a yokel is certainly not a compliment by any stretch.
And I love the reference to Siskel and Ebert. Now, you know, what I find interesting about that is they haven't been a pair. Now, mind you, I believe it's Siskel died in 99, right? Mm-hmm. But it's like we still talk, like when people review movies, I think to this day in my head, even though it's been over 20 years, I still think of Siskel and Ebert.
Same. I know that was one of the references too that I put in my notes. I was like, oh my God, people won't actually know what that is. Like if they're watching this first run.
At the Movies, which was originally Siskel and Ebert in the Movies, and later At the Movies with Ebert and Roper, was an American movie review television program produced by Disney, ABC Domestic Television, in which two film critics share their opinions of newly released films. Its original hosts were Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel, the former host of Sneak Previews on PBS, and a similarly tilted syndicated series. Following Siskel's death in 1999, Ebert worked with various guest critics until choosing Chicago Sun-Times colleague Richard Roper as his regular partner beginning in the year 2000.
I'm saying, and that's been 20, that's 20 years ago, but I mean, in my head, it's always Siskel and Ebert.
Same here.
So Shannon says, so the next time you want to see me in a hot tub, you should rent my upcoming straight-to-video classic, Ernest Pays for Sex, and don't forget to rewind.
Hey, Burns, I just love these outer space movies, don't you? This is my all-time favorite one, too. This is called Attack of the Moon People, and this is where the evil Vendor sends his atomic virus space pod to Earth to paralyze everybody so him and his evil buddies can just waltz in big as you please and stomp the living daylights out of everybody. Burn! Oh, no! It's Vendor's moon pod. Oh, no! We're gonna be paralyzed. And Vendor's gonna come in here and stomp the living daylights out of us.
Hey, Vern!
Hey, Vern!
Hey, Vern, it's me! I'm on TV!
I laughed so hard because I loved those Ernest movies. Do you guys remember those Ernest movies?
Of course.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Oh, I loved the, like, Ernest Goes to Camp, Ernest Scared Stupid.
Like, Chris, you're talking about, like, our wheelhouse of childhood. Like, we were probably, like, Luigi, what, like, 8 or 10 when those Ernest movies started coming out. But he had a show on, like, Nickelodeon as well.
Sure.
And that's sort of, like, where we grew up on Ernest. So, yeah, so, I mean, like, we were his prime audience. So, like, when I was, like watching this one now for this episode, I, like, you laugh so loud, Ernest pays for sex. And then, like, the, you know, be kind, rewind, or don't forget to rewind that she says. And, like, who's going to get that except people that are our age?
Right.
That's Blockbuster reference right there.
Imagine the perfect video store. It would have a great selection, right? Right. Over 10,000 videos. 3 evening rentals, so no rush, no hassle. Fast checkout. 24-hour quick drop return. Open late every night. Well, the perfect video store.
Welcome to Blockbuster Video.
Is popping up all over the country. There's one near you.
Blockbuster Video. Wow, what a difference.
Yeah, so, you know, that's a great reference. So let's talk about Blockbuster.
Yeah, I was going to mention, did you guys know that there's actually still a Blockbuster open? It's in Bend, Oregon. It's the last one open on Earth.
Yeah, there's a great biography, I guess you might call it, show about it on Netflix that came out last year. And I was watching it. I thought it was fabulous. And I actually shared it with Alex. I was texting with him, and he watched it and enjoyed it as well. Big recommend to all of our fans out there. You should check that out. It tells the story of Blockbuster, its rise and its fall.
Yeah, talk about like a company with, you know, just a lack of awareness of the changing tide of its own industry.
Yep.
I mean, like, I spent hours of my childhood there. Hours just trying to pick out a movie for a Friday, you know? And then now I just flip through a dozen streaming services trying to find the same movie.
Right. Yeah, definitely. At one point, I think they had an opportunity to buy Netflix very early in the game. And
Really?
You know, their thought process was, well, we know our customers and our customers are loyal. They like coming into the stores. They like the experience. And boy, were they wrong.
Wow, talk about hubris. Wow.
Right?
Well, you know, it's like being able to keep up with the times. Sheila, like Chris and I have spoke, you know, talk a lot about technology, like in terms of like what we see in in Married with Children. And it's like that period, 1987 to, you know, 1995, you know, we've talked about beepers, dial-up, you know, I mean, if you remember even, you know, computers without dial-up, like, you know, if you remember back in the early 90s.
Yeah, like a Commodore 64 and stuff.
You know,
yeah.
Cell phones, what they were like. I mean, today, you know, you talk about a phone or a mobile phone, and it's effectively a computer that one of the applications on it allows you to make phone calls. But, you know,
I don't use my phone for that.
But I'm saying, because if you think about it, it's like one of the things that you carry in your pocket. It's just that one piece of it, but there's like you have a calculator, you have a camera,
a compass for crying out loud, like.
And if you go back to the past, it's like, you know, if you didn't want to if you didn't want to be in touch with someone, you could very easily do it in the past. Now you can't.
Yeah, it's willful if you're not in touch.
Yeah, so one of the things I want to point out about the Ernest movies, there are, based on this, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 films where it says begin with Ernest, you know, does something. So Ernest Pays for Sex would have been the 10th.
That was pretty funny.
Somehow,
I cracked up.
Somehow, I think Jim Varney would have probably done that one for free.
Oh yeah, he would have. Oh, absolutely. And she delivered that line so good too.
And you know, like when she turns around, I don't know if like you notice her face as she's moving. It's like she has like this laugh and smirk on her face.
Felt like she was trying not to laugh.
Yeah. It's either she was trying not to laugh or it's like she was just like so. The real Shannon Tweed was very, what's the word I'm looking for? She was very proud of herself for how she was able to deliver it, you know, while keeping a straight face. You know, because it's like, you know, you're walking off, like off camera, but it's like almost like they got a glimpse of her as like, you know, she's coming out of character as she's walking off. But I thought that was, yeah, that was great.
Al, I got them up to 25,000. Now, I think we should make like Waterworld and close immediately.
I'm joking.
Well, why are you joking?
I said I'm joking!
Oh, you're joking! Okay, let me help you out. There, did you swallow what was stuck in your throat?
Yes, Jefferson, I did.
Good, and you're not choking anymore.
No,
but you are!
Jefferson's happy that he has them up to $25,000. So he says, I think we should make like Waterworld and close immediately. So Waterworld is a 1995 American post-apocalyptic action film directed by Kevin Reynolds and co-written by Peter Rader and David Tui. It's based on Rader's original 1986 screenplay and stars Kevin Costner, who also produced it with Charles Gordon and John Davis. It was distributed by Universal Pictures. This film suffered from runaway costs. I had a budget of $172 million, but the total outlay was about $235 million once marketing and distribution costs were factored in. But it only grossed $88 million in the U.S. and the North American box office, and overseas $176 million for a total of $264. So it didn't do very, very well. It took a while for it to become profitable. So Al decides to choke Jefferson once he fully swallows that picture in negative.
So I have a question for you guys. Y'all probably remember better than me because I was so young at the time. But you take film to be developed, you know, and they give you the pictures, you know, like a week later or whatever, several days later or whatnot.
If you want to pay extra, wouldn't an hour later.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, okay, and then they came out with the 1 hour developed.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that place still have the negatives?
No, they give you the negatives.
Yeah, you got them back.
They give you the negatives. Okay, yeah. So he swallowed the entire envelope that had the photo, the negatives.
Correct. Yeah. That's right.
Okay, because I was like, couldn't he just go back and have them develop again?
Yeah, well, no, because you see, back, that's why they had to put the negative in the envelope. Now, because like Sheila points out, back then, let's say you had some pictures, like let's say you took a special event, let's say it's like a kid's birthday, and you wanted more copies of it. Nowadays, what would you do? You would probably scan it, you know, nowadays you'd have it on your phone and you text it to somebody, right? And they keep it on their phone. But back then, it's like if you wanted to give grandma photos, it's like, well, you would just take the negatives back to the photo mat and they would reprint them for you. And that was the best way of getting the photos with the same level of quality. Because back then, if you had a photo and you wanted to make a copy of the photo and didn't have a negative, they would take a picture of the picture. And generally, you would lose quality, photo quality. So the only way you could get the original quality is to have the original negative.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So we cut back to the Bundy living room, and Al is in a hospital gown.
Come on.
So how was the hospital? Any luck getting the negative out?
No, Al's stomach acid dissolved it. But they did find 3/4 of a commemorative Slim Jim left over from Super Bowl XII.
That's what I've been tasting all these years. Well, despite losing the $25,000 and the cost for the visit to the hospital and a vintage Slim Jim, on the bright side is, whenever you're down, there's always TV to pick you back up.
So they say that, you know, Al's stomach acid dissolved it. But they found 3/4 of a commemorative Slim Jim left over from Super Bowl XII. Now, I can't say that I've ever eaten a Slim Jim.
Same.
Oh, I have.
So why don't you tell us, Chris?
Yeah, Slim Jim. Well, two reasons. One, it's just something I grew up eating it. And two, I was a big wrestling fan, and the Macho Man Randy Savage used to do his famous commercials.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Sure.
Step into a Slim Jim.
Step into a Slim Jim. Oh, yeah.
So boring.
Well, so how many high school boys does it take to change a light bulb?
Want to light up your life?
Yeah!
Step into a Slim Jim!
Ah!
boys! Baby, juicy taste! Need a little excitement? Snap it to a Slim Jim!
So, Slim Jim is an American brand of jerky snacks or dried sausage sold globally and manufactured by Conagra Brands. They are widely popular. They're widely available and popular in the U.S. with 2015 revenues of $575 million. About $500 million are produced annually in at least 21 varieties. I mean, when you think about $575 million in revenue, that's a really high number when you consider they basically make one thing. Dried sausage, and some of them come with cheese in it as well. That's the only thing they produce, and they have annual revenue of $575 million.
Wow.
Pretty effective.
All right, and, you know, they make this crack on Super Bowl XII, and I'm just trying to, I mean, I'm not a football guy. I mean, I don't know, Sheila, if you know anything about football, but what's so special about Super Bowl XII?
I don't know. It would have been, what, like 1972 or something?
Yeah, I was going to say, my guess is just the fact that it was so long ago at the time. It would have been, you know, 17 or 18 years, depending on how you look at it. You know, or maybe, you know what, maybe the writer producer was a really big fan of that particular Super Bowl. I don't know. That's what I was thinking. Yeah, Super Bowl XII was an American football game between the NFC champion Dallas Cowboys and the AFC champion Denver Broncos to decide the NFL champion for the 1977 season. The Cowboys defeated the Broncos 27-10 to win their second Super Bowl. The game was played on January 15, 1978 at the Louisiana Superdome in New Orleans. This was the first Super Bowl in a dome stadium, and the first time that the game was played in prime time in the eastern U.S. So just looking at those last two lines, it was a landmark for the Super Bowl. It was the first time the entire country saw it in prime time, and it was the first time it was played in a dome stadium. So that's a pretty big event.
I feel remiss. You know, Sheila will understand this. It's like I know very little about football, although the most famous Super Bowl a coach, manager of all time, Vince Lombardi, graduated from our high school.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Sorry, Vince.
Yeah, it's not a slight. It's just, I mean, I do watch football, but I don't know enough to, you know, have known why Super Bowl XII was significant.
So we end this episode with Kelly coming in, and we get to see the dog commercial.
Hey, everybody, listen. The Hungry Puppy commercial is going to come on.
Is your puppy hungry? Then get him Hungry Puppy Dog Food. The only food that puppies prefer to their own tails.
If doggy's nose is dry and his tongue is black and his ribs are showing through his back, give him Hungry Puppy a bite or two and your starving mutts will be good as new. Give him Hungry Puppy a bite or two and your starving mutts will be good as new.
Meow! Woof! I love Puppy Hungry.
That's Hungry Puppy.
Yeah, what he said.
Hungry Puppy, Hungry Puppy, Hungry Puppy.
And it's not what we thought it was. So what did you guys think of that commercial?
I mean, like, I did, like, I laughed and I eye rolled at the same time. Again, just playing into the stereotypes, but I did find it very funny.
Yeah, I never saw that coming. I still remember my first viewing of this as a kid, and I thought it was just going to be Lucky running through the obstacle course. When it was Kelly in that costume, I laughed so hard. You got to remember, I would have been 11, 12 when this episode came out, so I didn't get a lot of the adult jokes, but I enjoyed, you know, the craziness and the zaniness of the show, and this killed me as a kid. I just remember laughing so hard. And Christina Applegate, just, she does it so well. Her delivery of everything, she just owns it, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, one of the things we say on this show when we talk about it, Sheila, is how it takes an intelligent person to play stupid very well.
Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. So, yeah, I'll agree with that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, you know, the way that she plays it up to the camera, you know, I mean, it's like, I think at the end of the day, like the director wanted TNA, right? So she's in this, you know, costume, you know, like the skin tight costume, and like she's wiggling her butt. And like, I love how like she messes up the animals. It's like, it's the cat. Then it's like, you know, it's like the dog. Then she moves like a cow, and like, you know, she's like almost scratching herself like she has fleas. And she messes, yeah. It's like,
and Kelly, and yeah, and at the very end, Kelly's celebrating as if she did a great job.
Yeah. Yeah, she's proud of herself.
That's the final shot. Yeah, she's proud of herself. She's saying moo and meow and.
Oh God!
Whatever he said for the dog food name.
Yeah.
Oh God.
No, ma'am. We'll be right back to wrap up this week's review. Be sure to join their Facebook group page for all the podcast news and updates. Be sure to subscribe to them on the Apple Podcast app, and please leave a review telling them what you think of the show. To subscribe to their YouTube channel, just go to Channels and search up Married with Children Podcast. Join their Patreon and support your favorite podcast with a small monthly donation. You can email them at marriedwchildrenpodcast@gmail.com. Thanks for checking out this review.
And we're back. Okay, so Chris, how many 90s sitcoms do you want to slam for this episode?
Well, I really like this episode. It's probably my second favorite episode of season 10 behind the Terry Bradshaw episode. But I really, really enjoy this episode. I'm so glad that we got to review it. I feel like the writing is really strong in it. It has a great B plot, you know, the B plot with the Kelly and Bud and Lucky there was very strong. The A plot was amazing. You know, I enjoyed the guest stars we had, Shannon Tweed and the Swedish masseuses. I feel like it was just a great scenario that they put Al and Jefferson there, and Al had a chance to win, you know, finally get some money and get back at someone who wronged him. But in typical Al Bundy fashion, you know, he shot himself in the foot. But I feel like the writing was very strong. I had a lot of pop culture references from the 90s, which is, you know, the decade that I grew up in. So I got, you know, a good number of these references even as a kid. And looking back, I laugh at it hilariously now. So this is one of my favorite episodes in the later seasons. And I feel like they did a very, very good job. And I am going to give it 4.5 90s sitcoms out of 5.
Okay. Very good. Okay, so Sheila, how many 90s sitcoms are you going to slam for this episode?
Let's see. I don't know. I mean, they had some heavy hitters in this one to slam. I enjoyed this. I hadn't been back to Married with Children in a very long time. And to like step back into this realm with this episode, Chris, to your point, I think the writing was really good. Like, I remembered like the joke a minute elements of the sitcom aspect of that we got here. And I felt that that was very strong. I didn't mind the B plot of bringing in Lucky and Bud and Kelly, because the interaction between them and sort of the payoff of that plot really kind of like just hit this one out of the park for me. It was a lot of fun to watch. It was like, I watched it, I think, 3 times just to get ready for this. And I found myself just like anticipating the jokes and really just waiting for that. So I was excited to be part of, you know, getting back into Married with Children and being on here. So I will give it as well 4.5 out of 5 90s sitcoms getting slammed.
All right. Wow. Pretty high scores. We'll talk about that in a minute, Sheila. So for this episode, I am going to slam 4 90s sitcoms for this. I really liked the episode. I thought that the writing was excellent. There was a lot of, again, this is a late series episode for Married with Children, so there's a lot of TNA. You know, and usually that's not the kind of thing that actually draws me to an episode. You know, I think I've said on this podcast before, I love good writing. I love good humor. I like sophisticated humor, double entendre. The humor in the later seasons is very much in your face. You know, it's not sort of like that early season type of humor, but it worked. And I think, you know, even like, you know, as I think I gave a lot of credit to Shannon Tweed in this. It's like, so she's sort of playing up herself and she's playing a fictional version of herself. But I think she was very good, especially in her interaction with Al. It looked very believable. It looked genuine. And even when like she sort of shows her hand and sort of tells Al like she was in on like knowing exactly what was going on, it just seemed very believable to me. You know, and I feel like when she turned around like to exit the scene, it's like I think like she was very satisfied with herself. I think that's what when we see that smile. Like I think she was satisfied that she could deliver it properly. So I give that. So I give the episode a 4. I won't go higher than that because, you know, I feel like it probably a couple of areas it could have been done maybe a little bit better, a little more finesse to it. But very good solid 4 for me. Now, you know, one of the things, Sheila, about season 10 and 11, what we've talked about as we've been reviewing these now, is that usually we say that in the later seasons of Married with Children, the show had started to run out of gas. And, mm-hmm. you know, critically looking at these episodes, you know, I think both Chris and I, Chris, correct me if I'm wrong, you know, we went into this thinking that we'd be giving some of these episodes much lower scores. But so far, for the episodes that we reviewed this season, they've come out pretty good. I mean, we've actually given some pretty good scores, you know, looking at the episode on its own. I mean, would you agree?
Yeah, I would, actually. Definitely.
So, you know, not bad for a show that is in its 10th season, you know, and it still seems relevant and fresh.
Right. It is 25 years removed from when it originally aired. So it's like, how is it holding up against the test of time as well?
Correct. One of the things we do in this podcast is we talk about the nostalgia elements and, you know, we talk about what was going on during that time period. And, you know, we include things like commercials and, you know, other types of media that, you know, was familiar just to set the tone. But something like this with, I'm saying, I believe that if someone was a young person, let's say someone who's 20 years old, who's watching this, you know, and so somebody born in 2001, watching this, I mean, may not get some of those 90s references, but I think a person would still laugh. It's still funny.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. They might have to ask their parents, what does don't forget to rewind mean?
Or who's Brett Butler, right?
Right.
So Sheila, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. This was really fun.
Yeah, so why don't you tell the fans a little bit about your podcast? Like, where can they find you?
So I'm on Twitter. I'm Shields McGangsta on Twitter, and I'm there pontificating about all things entertainment. But you can also find Pod Clubhouse on all the social media platforms at Pod Clubhouse. And there you'll find interviews, you'll find TV reviews, you'll find something called the Love It or Leave It, where we'll review a whole season of a show, and we'll tell you if it's worth your time or not, just to help you sift through that pop culture world. There's reviews on film festivals and comic cons and live events. So yeah, there's something for everybody at Pod Clubhouse, and you're always welcome to join Pod Clubhouse.
Now, one more question for you, Sheila. So how is like the way that, you know, we do our podcast, you know, the same or different than yours?
Similar. I mean, you know, some of the setup on Pod Clubhouse, what we'll do is we'll cover like a season. So we'll cover each episode in depth, and they're typically contemporary shows that are out, so we're trying to do it like in time for when the episode drops, so we get screener access for a lot of different things, so we'll get to see stuff ahead of time, so it's not always in its final production. So it's a little bit different because we're usually up against the clock and we're trying to like juggle everyone's schedules to try to get everything out. But in terms of the format, it's pretty much the same. Like, we would have like questions lined up about the show, about the episode, about the plot. And then if there's any like culture references, and it's always better to do it with more than one person, because I may have missed the you know, Brett Butler reference and forgetting that Grace Under Fire was a show. So you want to have like these different perspectives and these different opinions to see, you know, who remembers what, and then you end up having like great banter conversation, like the Blockbuster conversation. You know, like, I live for these tangents in podcasts, really, because like I feel like that's where like you get to see the personality of the hosts and how they interact with each other. So I think there's a lot of similarities in how like the Pod Clubhouse setup is to yours.
Yeah, and you know, and Chris can attest to this. I mean, we're just copying something that our creator of this podcast did because we didn't want to mess with perfection, right, Chris?
Yeah, like if you have something that works, definitely. Just you keep it going, right?
If it ain't broke, don't fix it, right?
That's right, right, Chris. We're not.
Yeah,
we're not that creative, right?
No, I wouldn't shoot yourself in the foot because it does take a lot to keep something like this fresh for people who are either new to it or people who have grown up with the show, so to speak, to make something that is 25, 26 years old relevant today. So I wouldn't knock yourself because there is an art to this and there is, you know, a way to build an audience, and having a good template and having, you know, predictable features like your ratings and things like that are things that your fans would look forward to.
And we have a great group of fans.
Well, that's what makes it all worth it.
Yeah,
right?
I mean, like we still get peanuts on our Patreon, but at this point, we really don't care anymore, right, Chris?
Right. Yeah, it's just all about the fun for me.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think we could get maybe like one beer a month at the nudie bar. I think at most.
Maybe if you save up, you can get an I Fish Therefore I Am sweatshirt.
Yeah. All right. Well, Sheila, thanks again. And be sure, you know, to our fan base out there, be sure to check her out. All right. And Sheila, can you give us that info one more time?
Yeah, sure. It's Pod Clubhouse on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, podclubhouse.com. And yeah, definitely check out Pod Clubhouse. There's something for everybody there.
Awesome. All right. And that's it for this week's episode of the Married with Children podcast. Tune in next week for Dud Bowl 2. Marcy's Bank, Kyoto National, plans to donate a new scoreboard to Polkai and name it after Polkai's most famous football alumnus. Al, having scored 4 touchdowns in a single game, assumes it's him. But Marcy hates Al and is determined to find another football star just to spite him. When she learns that NFL All-Star Terry Bradshaw attended Polkai for 2 months, she thinks she has found her man. While Kelly tries to talk to Bradshaw about letting Al have the title, Al Jefferson and Bud conspire to destroy the scoreboard. So again, thanks again. Thank you again, Sheila. And tune in next week. Same Bundy time, same Bundy channel.